I present to you and to the church family Justice Lyric Shannon. And I'd like for you all to stand out, hold her up, so that the church can see her. And Pleasant Green, I want you to pray for this couple. I want you to pray for this entire family. Keep them bathed in your prayer. Our prayers go with you, not symbolically, but literally. We are praying that you will be not the Marines' man, but you'll be God's man. And you'll be God's woman. Amen. Amen. God bless each of you. You might go back and take a seat.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Can we give God a hand clap praise? Come on, we can do better than that. Can we give God some praise? Amen. This song has really been on my heart, and this is going out for anybody that's gone through anything traumatic in your life. How many of y'all gone through something traumatic in your life? But God told me to tell you this morning that He cares for you. Amen. Let's give Sister Sharon a hand as she blesses us. Amen.
So you think that you can't make it through, and you feel like all of your hope is gone. Just remember, God cares for you, and He knows just what's best for you. He cares. He cares. That you, oh, you just can't make it through. And sometimes you feel like all of your hope is gone. It's all gone. Oh, but you got to remember, God, He cares for you. He knows just what's best for you.
Yeah, yeah.
He cares. He cares for you. Jesus knows. You've got to keep the faith. Hold on, come with me, because He cares. He cares for you.
Jesus knows. Jesus cares.
Jesus cares. Don't you ever give in. Keep the faith. Hold on to His hand. Come what may. He cares. He cares. Trust God. Believe God. Because He cares.
He cares. I know He cares.
Yeah.
Some songs you can identify with a little bit more than you can other songs. And I just saw the Lord work some things out this past week. Worried about it, trying to figure it out, calling up folk, trying to work it out. And the Holy Spirit said, leave it alone. Get up the next morning, got two calls, two of the problems, he had worked it out. I didn't have nothing to do with it, didn't call up nobody, but God had worked it out. And so I said, well, Lord, if you worked out these two, then the third one is already worked out. I'm sure, maybe not, but there might be one or two persons wondering, why is the pastor dressed so leisurely and his background is suited in a very smart and good-looking way? Well, I'm going to explain what happened. I thought this Sunday was the last Sunday for leisure wear. I was told last Sunday, and I said, no, I don't wear no leisure wear for the Lord's Supper. That's not proper. So I wear my suit last Sunday, then I wear my leisure wear this Sunday, then I look up and every preacher comes in with their suit on. So I say, you can't win, that's the way life is. So I don't worry about it no more. I've reached the point that things like that just don't bother me. If you have your Bible, turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And let's spotlight verses 7 to 10. 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, and 7, 8, 9, 10, and those four verses from 7 to 10. Amen. May we all stand as we honor the word of God. 2 Corinthians, chapter 12, and beginning at the 7th verse, and stopping at verse 10. And as always, I'm reading from the New International Version. This is Paul speaking here. Paul says, to keep me from becoming conceited because of these surpassingly great revelations, there was given me a thorn in my flesh, messenger of Satan, to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. For when I am weak, then and only then, I am strong. You may be seated. This message is going to, I guess, be in two parts. The first part is going from a handicap to a gift. Going from a handicap to a gift. And then the latter part of this message, I want us to look at the benefits of a thorn. The benefits of the word. Benefits means the advantages of a thorn. Many of you are familiar with what Paul says here in this entire 12th chapter, But even if we go back to chapter 11, why he is saying here what he says, and then going on to chapter 13. Before I begin, let me give just a general, basic approach to any scripture that you read. First of all, pray and ask the Holy Spirit to open up your insight, to give you wisdom and to give you understanding. And then, whatever passage you're reading, just ask four simple questions. Who, what, when, and where? Very simple. Who is speaking? What is being done? Why are they saying what they are saying? And where, in terms of the background, what brought on this statement? Because nobody says anything in a vacuum, just to be saying it. There are motives and reasons behind what we articulate through our mouths. And this message came out of a conversation that I had with a person several weeks ago. And as I was sharing with them, the Holy Spirit just rattled this off. And after I got through speaking to that person, I thought to myself, my Lord, God, you're an awesome God. That was the beginning, that was the birth of this message. For all of us in life, nobody can escape the pressures of life. Most of us have known the feeling of disappointment, and if you haven't, as the old saying goes, keep living. We have known the sting of rejection, the sorrow of failure. There comes a time, though, in every life when the parts, and I'm saying this figuratively, when the parts that are covering, when the lids that are covering the parts, and they boil, and they keep on boiling till they reach a point that the lids, they pop off and they crash to the floor. Which is implying this, that sometimes in life people have financial needs. Maybe there's somebody here this morning that you're facing a relationship crisis, and you've been urgently praying for God's wisdom and direction. But whatever your problem is, whatever that thorn is, you can trust this principle, and I'm going to repeat it. And the principle is this: whatever brings you to your knees in weakness carries the greatest potential for your personal success and your spiritual victory. Let me say that again. Whatever thorns, problems, trials, troubles, hardships, whatever brings you to your knees in your weakest hour, that carries the greatest potential for your personal success and for your spiritual victory. In our text here, Paul was facing enemies. And who were those enemies? They were false apostles. Paul called them super apostles. They were also twisted teachers. And they came not only from the Gentiles, but they also came from the Jews. Because backing up, Paul had to, by night, secretly escape from Damascus by some friends of his, putting him in a basket, lowering him over the wall, just like he was a criminal breaking out of a prison. And if you know anything about the character of Paul, you know that that really hurt Paul deeply. That was extremely embarrassing to this man of letters and scholar. These super apostles that Paul called them, what were they doing? They were perverting the gospel message. They were disrupting the church family. They were disturbing the peace and the tranquility of God's people. They were impugning Paul's character. They were discrediting the gospel, and they were assassinating Paul's apostleship. They were also slandering his reputation. And they were trying to tear down what Paul had built up, or what God had built up through Paul in that city where that little band of Christians were. They were insinuating that Paul's M.O. was false. In other words, Paul had lied to the believers and the followers in Corinth. And what he told them, it was not true. What they were saying to the folk was true. So they were trying to undermine Paul and tear down what God had established through Paul there in the city of Corinth. Paul, in order to get the attention of these Christians in Corinth, he used the method of his critics, and he answered them in their own language, and that was boasting and bragging about who they were, what they could do, and how great they were. That's why Paul called them super apostles. Now, Paul, before he started the bragging, he said now to them, to the Christians in Corinth, he said, this is foolishness. This is stupidity. It does not make sense. But since you are listening to this foolishness, to this babble that they are giving you, well, I'm going to be foolish like them for a moment. In other words, I'm going to espouse stupidity. And I'm going to let you know that they are not the only ones that brag about they had visions, revelations. Paul says, I'm going to tell you something that I've never told anybody else. But because of this situation, he said, I feel as though that this hopefully will get your attention and get your ears. He said, 14 years ago, which means prior to this incident, what he was talking now, and which scholars say was around about 40 AD, he said, I had a vision. And he said, and Paul put it in the third person. He said, I'm not going to brag about me, but there was a man that I knew, which we know that it was Paul talking about himself. But he said, now I'm not saying nothing about me, but this man was caught up in the third heaven, which is paradise. And he heard revelations, and he saw things that he could not believe. But not only that, what he saw and what he heard, he was admonished to keep his mouth shut, not to say nothing about it. He could not reveal these revelations, for they were special revelations. And then Paul says, to make certain that unconsciously I spill the beans, he said, God used Satan to send a messenger, which in the Greek was another demon. And it was like a thorn in my side. And it buffered me. It was irritating. It hurt. There was a lot of pain that I had to endure. And he said the reason why God did this, he wanted to keep me humble and keep my mouth closed. Are you with me? Does that sound like folk today in our pop culture? All right. And he said, I prayed three times, and we don't know whether it was, you know, in succession, but in terms of the number of prayers, and they could have been intermittent prayers at different times, but three times he prayed, and his prayer was simple. Lord, if you take this pain away, if you remove this thorn, I can do a greater work for you. I can do some things that have never been done before in your name. And after the third time, excuse me, he asked God for this. God said, no. He answered the man, but he didn't give the answer that Paul wanted to the prayer. He said, I'm going to let the thorns stay there. I'm going to keep you crippled. I'm going to let this handicap remain in your life. But, and you've heard me say this many times before, whenever God gives a but, there's always victory on the other side. But with the thorn, I am going to give you an abundance of my grace. And it will be sufficient. The word sufficient means it will be enough. It will be adequate in order for you to live with the thorn. But yet you're going to live above the thorn, and you're going to do what? Greater work in my name. Well, Paul, when he was lifted up in that revelation, he was lifted up in an atmosphere of glory. But when he came back, and also he made mention of the fact, he didn't know whether this man that this happened to, whether he bodily went up to heaven, whether he went up in his spirit, but it really doesn't matter. He said that after this happened, he went from glory to pain. And to put it in the words of the Olympic phraseology, he went from ecstasy to what? To agony. Now, there are many commentators that have speculated on what the thorn was. In actuality, we don't know. And let me tell you something else. It ain't important what the thorn was. But we're going to get to the purpose of the thorn. But I want to suggest some ideas that commentators and scholars have thrown out over the years in terms of what they thought the thorn was. One of them said that it was a spiritual temptation. This was John Calvin's view, which meant that he said that Paul had some doubt and he was shrinking from the duties of an apostolic life. And then Martin Luther, his view was that this thorn was Paul's opposition and persecution that he had to face day in and day out. Those persons who tried to undo his work and tried to tear down what he had built up. Then there were some monks in the 17th century that said that this thorn was sexual temptations. And then some of them said that this thorn was Paul's physical appearance, that he had a disfigurement, that he was ugly. And when the people saw him, it wasn't in terms of what they had pictured when they listened or they read what he wrote. Then some said this was epilepsy. And naturally, epilepsy will produce visions and trances. And then some said that Paul, this thorn, was severe headache. And this was held by some of the church fathers. And then number seven, some of them said that Paul suffered from eye trouble. And there is some biblical undergirding from this. In Galatians chapter 4, verse 15, Paul says to the Galatians, he says that, I know that you love me so much that you are willing to pluck out your eyes and give your eyes to me. And then in Galatians chapter 6, verse 11, Paul tells them, I'm writing you with large letters, implying that I have to write large so I can see. But now we cannot be definite about this. And then finally, some commentators said that Paul had malaria, a fever. Well, again, it could be there are maybe some good suggestions there. But again, as I said before, it's not important about what the thorn was. That's not the purpose of what God did. The message is not in what it was, but what the thorn did. Now let me suggest the benefits of the thorns. The benefits of the thorn. And you said, now that doesn't harmonize with in terms of what a thorn is, because in Greek that word meant like a stake that would go through a person's body or would nail them to a cross, something like that. Something that would pierce the body and bring excruciating pain, like when Jesus was hanging on the cross. Now, how can this thorn bring a benefit in Paul's life? Let me say it another way. How can Paul be blessed by a thorn? Amen? Let me suggest five things. You ready? We're on the roller coaster, and we're going fast. And if you ain't strapped in, you're going to fall out, and we don't have any paramedics to help you. Why did God do this? First of all, God gave Paul a handicap to live with, not temporarily, but permanently. This was for the rest of his life. Somebody that's listening to me on the sound of my voice and looking at me now, you have been battling with a handicap, a thorn, in your life, most of your life, and you are realizing now that that handicap is not going to be removed. You're going to have to learn how to what? Adjust to it, live with it, and ask God for more of his power to go forth in your life. Amen? Some things in our lives ain't going to change. Children can be thorns. Hey, help me, Lord. Whether you say amen or not, I'm going to say amen for you. Because sometimes my children are thorns. And ain't nobody here got no perfect kids. Amen? Husbands can be thorns at times. Oh, I got an amen on that one. Been getting no amen on the children, but I got an amen on the husband. Have mercy, Lord, that they don't want to admit that. But wives can be thorns. Extended families can be thorns. Aunts, uncles, cousins, whatever, you know. Up-laws, in-laws, down-laws, it don't matter. They can get on your nerves. And especially when they are not saved. Now that will grieve your spirit. If it's a daughter-in-law or son-in-law not saved, and your child, your daughter or your son, they are saved, that creates a spiritual conflict in your soul. Does it not? I am. Thank you. The next thing is, thorns disrupt a person's comfort zone. Thorns disrupt a person's comfort zone. How does a thorn do that? By invading and unsettling your peace. It distresses you. It becomes an irritation in your life. It becomes a pain. Till you reach the point you pray so long and it doesn't change, then Satan tells you, give up. It ain't worth it. Live with it and march on. Have you ever had the enemy to tell you that? put those thoughts in your mind. When things in your life are going decently well, and I'm using this figuratively, the waters of your life are placid, smooth, calm. Don't start to feeling good and poking your chest out. And somebody sitting next to you on the pew, they're talking about their troubled waters. And you're thinking to yourself, "Boy, I feel sorry for them. They're in bad shape." And just because your waters are calm and peaceful, wait a while. If you think you're going to leave this world without your waters being disturbed and upset, you're foolish. Because it don't take but one little pebble that the enemy throws, skip all across the water, and all of a sudden you start seeing ripples. And see, one thing about sin is not content. Oh, thank you. Sin is not content to just destroy itself or destroy the person that it's invading. But sin is greedy. And it has to, through that person, it has to what? Spill over to other people's lives that had nothing to do with it, didn't even know what's coming on. So other people suffer. Oh, help me, Lord. The next thing is this. Thorns will drive you to depend on God in prayer. Paul said, "I prayed three times," because he had come to his wit's end. And if you've ever had this experience where you use up all of your options and you ain't got no more options, and the only thing that's left for you, a little voice whispers and said, "Tell it to the Lord." Have you ever had that to happen? Paul said, "I had to carry it to the Lord because the Lord was the one that permitted it to happen." And we know this. Satan can't do anything without God's permission. Take the life of Job. Everything that happened to Job, God gave permission through Satan. But then God drew a line. And the Satan, that's as far as you're going to go. And no matter, Satan wanted to kill Job, literally. He wanted to take his life. But God said, "Uh-uh. You can't touch him. You can maybe afflict his body, his flesh. But beyond that, this is as far as I'm going to let you go." And don't you know, and I'm coming to a close, because this message is cutting a lot of folk thornly. Don't you know that God loves you, that he cares for you? He's not going to let the enemy destroy your life. Now, he will break you down into crumbs. Whenever I eat soup or chili, how many like chili, homemade chili soup? I love to get wheat crackers. I don't eat white crackers no more because they say that white flour ain't good for you. So, you know, I try to be as healthy as possible. When I eat my wheat crackers, I like to crumble them up. Get a four or five of them and crumble them up. Put them in my soup and in my chili. And then I stir it up. Now, that's me. Some of y'all turn up your nose. That's my taste. Some of y'all got some crazy ways of eating too. That's what I like. Sometimes God will take you, as so to speak, like I take those crackers, and he'll break you. He'll break you down to crumbs. But he won't leave you as a crumb. Oh, help me, Lord. He will reconstitute the crumbs. He will put you back together again. But this time, you're going to taste better than you did the first time. And now, I've had him to do that in my life. In fact, I thought that in terms of my relationship with him, I thought everything was okie dokie. But the Lord said to me, it ain't okie dokie. I'm not satisfied with it because you can grow more. I didn't put you here to be satisfied at a certain level and a certain faith degree in your life. I want you to become great. And I'm the only one that can make you great because you're not going to push yourself. Now, what I'm going to do, it ain't going to feel good. You ain't going to like it. You're going to get angry with me. But I don't care. You get mad with me. It's just like when my children were coming up, I would tell them some things. But in fact, even there, my grandson Vaughn, I'd tell him to do some things, and he'd look at me. And I'll tell him, I said, boy, if you don't do it, I'm going to get my belt on you. Then he'll tell me, granddad, I don't like you. I said, that's nice. I don't care whether he likes me or not. I'm not disciplining him for him to like me. God doesn't work in our lives, or God doesn't refrain from crushing us because we're good folk, because he likes us. He wants us what? To be great. Followers of Jesus Christ. Then Paul says, that thorn that he gave me, thorns have the ability to keep you humble. Thorns will keep your ego in check. Thorns will keep you from bragging about who you are. Because God don't care. And like you brag about who you are, God has got somebody greater than what you think you are. You ain't the only pebble on the beach. You might be good, but God always has something, what, better in life. Thorns keep you from bragging about your achievements, your obtainments, what you have done, your self-sufficiency. You see, you can't draw folk to Jesus Christ talking about you. Oh, I wish I had some shouting folk this morning. You cannot draw folk to Christ talking about you because you really ain't worth talking about. Because there was a time when you were nothing. Now God has made you something. And oh! What he's made you in terms of a child of his. And he has what? Before he brought you into a relationship with him, he had to clean you out on the inside. He had to get to your mind and to your heart. He had to get that selfishness out of you. Your aggrandizement. Your what you thought you were in terms of your degrees. I'm Dr. Barnum. God don't care nothing about a doctor's degrees. If it hadn't been for him, I wouldn't have died that. What God is concerned about, he wants me to be a servant. Nobody wants to be a servant. Everybody wants to be a chief. But nobody wants to be an engine. Well, I'm just about through. I see some frowns. But my prayers are with you. God bless you. Thorns, though, contradictory to what they normally do, thorns will bring joy in your life. Sounds crazy, doesn't it? Paul said, when I'm weak, that's when I am strong. Paul said, I will gladly rejoice in my trials, my tribulations, my persecutions, my setbacks. He said, they don't bother me now. But at first, he was zeroing in on his handicap. But then he realized that that handicap was a gift in his life. God turns handicaps to gifts depending upon our perception of what he's doing in me. Oh, glory. Lastly, thorns keep me sensitive to the voice of eternity. You remember when Saul, the king, when he was chasing David? Remember that? And you know that David had not done anything to Saul. David didn't tell Saul, "I want your kingship, that I'm better suited to be a king than you are." But the people was telling Saul that. They said when they went to battle, "Saul, yeah, he killed thousands of warriors, but David killed his 10,000. You can't listen to folk. People embellish lies. They add on. They take away. Go to God in prayer. Amen? Pleasant Green? Let God tell you what, when, and where.